Good morning, all the participants. Now we are playing ICAI motto song. I request all the participants to put their right hand on their heart. Now I request Chairman of Ahmedabad branch, C.A. Fanil Shah, with whose vision we all are able to hear Rashmin Bhai in this block now. So C.A. Fanil Shah, sir.
Thank you, Bishan Bhai. You're very learned senior speaker, C.A. Rashmin Sangwiji from Mumbai. I can say that how much very little I know him, that he is not only known for his learnings, but he is also known for his spiritual talks, very lucidly merging the spirituality with the basic concepts of our learning, and also known for his philanthropic nature. So Rashmin Bhai, I'm so grateful to welcome you here on this platform of Ahmedabad branch. The chairman of various other branches of Gujarat joining with us, the chairman of Direct Tax Committee, C.A. Sunil Sangvi, the secretary sir of our branch, C.A. Bishan Shah, and all the members attending from Ahmedabad, I welcome you all to this morning to learn with respect to this international taxation. When Rashmin sir is there, I need not to do any single announcement before we start, but again one small announcement. Friends, today after in evening at 4 p.m. we are having a very fruitful panel discussion on investment, for which I announced yesterday also, and right now also you might have received the SMS with respect to that. Kindly register, because we are having very limited seats with respect to that. And also tomorrow morning, we are having a session on Samvad, that is C.A. Nitin Parekh, the CFO of Cadila Healthcare Limited. He is a thorough professional, and he, similar way as Rashmin sir does, he also merges the spirituality with the professional learnings. So he is going to talk on that, how can we can have a peace of mind in this COVID time. And when we have some professional, then he will tell us that how he also inculcates the same learning in his professional life also. So kindly take the benefit of that particular webinar also. With this brief words, I again welcome Rashmin sir, and now I request Sunil Sangviji to take the session further.
Thank you, Fanil Bhai. I welcome today's faculty, C. Rashmin Bhai Sangvi, dignitaries on the dais, seniors and friends. Today's topic, we know, amendment to residence status, Section 6 of the Income Tax Act. We know that in the condition, the 182 days are replaced by 120 days for the individuals whose income is more than 15 lakhs. The new concept of deemed resident has been introduced. NRIs now need to carefully plan their travel to India, keeping in mind their income. Today's faculty is from Mumbai. C. Rashmin Bhai Sangvi is a founder partner of Rashmin Sangvi and Associates. He has expertise in the field of international taxation, FEMA. Sir has made various presentations in the conference of ICAI, BCA, Chamber of Tax Consultant, Income Tax Department Conference, and several other institutions in the field of international taxation, cross-border investments, FEMA. He was also appointed by the CBDT on e-commerce committee in the year 1999, and again he was reappointed in the year 2015. This committee drafted the report on the equalization levy, which was introduced by the Finance Act 2016. Sir has also written books on the digital taxation, which was published in the last year only, year 2019, by the Taxman. With this brief introduction, I would request sir to start the session.
Good morning, friends. I'm happy to share with you, and I think despite this pandemic, the institute has found out very good medium so that all of us can still keep sharing our knowledge. Today's subject is residential status provisions as amended by Finance Act 2020. Now, normally we jump to a section and start interpreting individual words and sentences, but I will first take about 10 minutes time to give the full background. The article which has been emailed to all of you, it's a long article that I have given last 30 years history. But in reality, this provision has more than 80 years history. And all that history has today culminated into a tremendous chaos. The interpretation of the law is now going to be extremely difficult. Now, in this situation, how do you interpret a law? That is what I will briefly explain. And then, of course, I'll go to individual sections in the controversies which are arising because of that. My submission is that before interpreting any particular section, we should understand the structure and the scheme of the entire law. For example, when we talk of Income Tax Act, there are certain fundamental sections. Section 1 gives the jurisdiction of the Income Tax Act. We generally, after passing CA, nobody looks at Section 1, but the Vodafone's entire case was fought under Section 1. So it is also, and when we come to international taxation, Section 1 is very important. Section 4 is the charging section. Section 5 gives the scope of total income, and Section 6 gives the residential status. Now, in international taxation, as most of us know, there are two connecting factors. If government of India wants to tax any individual or any SSC or his income, government must have a jurisdiction. That jurisdiction to tax is achieved by one of the two connecting factors. One is scope of total income or source. If the income is sourced in India, then India is the country of source, or as in brief we say COS. If the SSC is resident of India, then we say India is the country of residence. So residential status is the connecting factor. This point I will discuss a little bit more further, but right now what I wanted to say is sections 1, 4, 5 and 6 constitute the four pillars of taxation for income tax. Now section 9 extends the scope of section 5. So wherever the income cannot be taxed under section 5 and government wants to still tax the income, then they make deeming provisions under section 9. In today's presentation, we will focus on section 6. And as far as section 5 issues arise out of this amendment, that we will discuss. Otherwise, section 9 and section 1, etc., we will not discuss. Once these four pillars of income tax are understood, then come the computation of income provision, section 14 onwards, salary income, business income, house property income, and so on. After the computation provisions, we have certain deeming provisions or anti-avoidance provisions like transfer pricing, GAR, and all that. And then come the procedural provisions. Now, before interpreting a section, if we know why that section was brought in, even the fundamental provisions, computation provisions, and especially anti-avoidance provision. When there is, for example, a transfer pricing provision, why the government of India considered it necessary to bring in transfer pricing provision? If you know the history, what tax planning was being done earlier, then interpreting the chapter of transfer pricing becomes very easy. Today, in a similar manner, we are talking of section 6. Okay, why the government considered under the finance bill that section 6 should be amended, some provisions should be added. Okay, so for that I will explain two essential tax planning which were going on, which government of India wanted to curb as on 1st February as per the finance bill. The one, as I have said in the preface, which is before you, there is paragraph P1, which very briefly gives the list. There are two essential provisions under section 6, subsection 1 in the explanation 1B. Government wanted to reduce the number of days from 182 days to 120 days. And the second provision which they wanted to bring in as anti-avoidance provision was to consider a stateless person as an Indian resident, even if he otherwise is not an Indian resident. Now, what is a stateless person? That also I have explained. But as we come to subsequent paragraphs, we'll say, right now I am on the preface. I'm going further. A stateless person is a person who is not liable to income tax for the residential status. We have just now discussed there are two connecting factors. Out of the two factors, if he is liable for the connecting factor of source, that is not a problem. But if he is not liable to tax in any country for the residential status, then that person will be covered as a stateless person. And now here, there are so many tax havens around the world, but some tax havens like Singapore, they do levy a tax quasi residential status. So if a person, an Indian citizen, is a resident of Singapore, he will not be covered by section 6, subsection 1A. But if a person is a resident of United Emirates, UAE, okay, then he will be covered, because in UAE, there is no income tax on individuals. This statement which I just now made has become a controversial statement, and I am dealing with all the controversies as we proceed further. Now, when these two anti-avoidance provisions were proposed on 1st February through the finance bill, there was a lot of hue and cry. And the hue and cry was mainly from UAE, because those people staying in UAE, they were directly affected. People staying in USA, for example, or UK, they're not at all affected. Because if you are resident of USA, then USA levies you tax, normal tax there. So person would not be covered by subsection 1A. So they did not raise a lot of hue and cry. But even a US resident would be covered by the amendment proposed in explanation 1B, meaning the reduction of number of days to 120 days. Since there was a hue and cry, government wanted to bring about anti-avoidance provision. This is what I have written in my paragraph P5. Okay. Now, this use of this term of anti-avoidance has a specific purpose. As we proceed further, we will have a look at it. Now I have completed preface, then after I am starting with residential status. I have reproduced, those of you who would like to refer to my article after the presentation is over, then section 6 is also reproduced here. Now I am on paragraph 1.2, and now we will, for next few minutes, we'll discuss explanation 1B. We started liberalization in the year 1991. That liberalization was forced because those of you who remember the year 1991, India was on the brinks of insolvency. The then Prime Minister V.P. Singh announced that Indian Treasury is empty. Now, in this situation, everybody was worried, but even before Mr. V.P. Singh could do anything, the government changed. Mr. Narasimha Rao became the Prime Minister and Dr. Manmohan Singh became the Finance Minister. Under the guidance of IMF, a lot of liberalization was carried out. Now, at that time, government was so much worried about getting foreign exchange into the country, getting foreign investment into the country, that government was not worried if somebody was doing any tax avoidance or even tax evasion. So government was liberal, and we signed treaties with UAE, with Mauritius, Cyprus, Malta, which were all tax havens. Government went ahead and signed treaties with these tax havens. In those times, when we invited people to invest in India, there were some issues. Now here I am coming to pre these amendments. If a person would come to India even for 60 days, he would become Indian resident. This is the provision of Section 61C. 61C provides that if a person comes to India for even 60 days, and if in the preceding 4 years he was in India for 365 days, then this 2 months presence would make him Indian resident. That would also mean that his global income would be taxable in India. Now, NRI said that if you want us to invest in India, meaning not just house property or portfolio investment, but if you want us to set up a business in India, then of course we have to come to look after our business. And if you tell us that we will be liable to Indian tax on our global income just because we have come to India to look after our business, then we will not invest in India. So government found their representation legitimate. And in the year 1994, Explanation 1B was amended to provide that a person who is outside India and comes on a visit to India, he will not be treated as an Indian resident if he comes to India for less than 182 days. So please understand, the limit of 182 days was extended to NRI visitors in India. Right now I am using only the simple language. When we come to the technicalities and controversies, then we will use the technical language. Point is, 182 days were granted to NRIs because government of India wanted them to invest in India. Now this relief was abused, because at that time in the year 1994, Section 6, subsection 6, making provision for not ordinarily resident, it provided that if a person is non-resident for just 2 years, then he can remain NOR for next 9 years. Okay, so now what was the planning going on? If an Indian resident wanted to convert his black money into white, I'm saying these are the facts. I'm not recommending anything to be done, but this is what was being done by so many people, that a person would leave India on 15th September of a financial year. He would return to India on 15th October of the next year. Thus, he would be outside India for 13 full months, and he would be non-resident for his both previous years. Okay, if he is a non-resident for both the previous years, then he would also be recognized as NOR for next 9 years. During these 2 years of his being non-resident of India, he would incorporate SPVs abroad, and then those SPVs would earn crores of rupees. Ostensibly, they would be earning crores of rupees in Dubai or some such emirate within UAE. There will be no income tax in UAE, so he will get a huge income tax free. What was happening was, in fact, this news has come in newspapers also, that people were sending their black money to Dubai through several hawala schemes. They were depositing this money in UAE bank account, and it was possible at that time that you just carry cash with you and deposit the money in bank account. Then that money was going to Mauritius, from Mauritius. Now this scandal came to the knowledge of government of India. Hence, they amended section 6, subsection 6. The NOR provision was reversed so that only if a person is non-resident for 9 years, then he would get an NOR status for 2 years. From third year onwards, hello? Hello, can you hear me? Hello. Hello, Vishen bhai. Hello.
Yes, Rasmit bhai.
Hello, is it? हाँ, बच्चे बंद हो गए लोग? हेलो
हाँ बोलो Rasmin, if you are facing net speed is slow, then video may be switch off.
No, Sunil bhai, I can't hear you. Okay. Okay. Vishan bhai sath hai. Vishan bhai ke.
I'm calling you, Rasmin.
हाँ जी हाँ सुनील भाई
सर सर वी कैन हियर यू यू आर परफेक्टली फाइन सर
ओके ओके आई कॉल इफ एनी वन ऑफ यू रिमेन ऑन द स्क्रीन इफ देयर इज एनी प्रॉब्लम देन आई कैन रियलाइज अदरवाइज आई थॉट नोबडी कैन हियर मी
सर वी आर देयर ओनली एंड वी आर हियरिंग सर सो इफ देयर इज एनी प्रॉब्लम विल डेफिनेटली कम नो प्रॉब्लम सर वी आर हियर ओनली बट
हाँ,
yes sir.
अच्छा, I am proceeding further. Okay, so this tax evasion and conversion of black money into white was going on. That is why government amended section 6, subsection 6, reversed the provision of NOR status. Hence, it became very difficult for people to continue their old schemes. Then people started having a new scheme. And that is in paragraph 1.6, where what people did, they became non-resident and they stayed non-resident because after the year 1994, it was possible for them to visit India for 181 days every year. And Dubai being at just 3 hours distance from India, it was possible that people would come to India, manage their Indian business, again go abroad, manage their foreign business, and thus a non-resident of India, and they would continue that status for 5 years, 10 years, whatever number of years. While they would be non-resident of India, they would not be liable to Indian income tax on their global income. Now, this provision is very legitimate, but what NRIs were doing was they were converting their Indian black money into white. This also came to the notice of Government of India. And that is why Finance Bill proposed to reduce the number of days from 182 days to 120 days. Meaning, if the Finance Bill provision had gone through, then an NRI would be able to come to India only for 119 days. Now, these people having genuine business in India would find it very difficult. So there was a class of NRI. They made a hue and cry about this provision. This is the provision under subsection 1, section 6, subsection 1, explanation 1B. Okay. Now, from this, this is the entire history of why finance bill provision was brought in. And of course, in short, I can say that because of the hue and cry raised by NRIs, section 6.6 was amended. All these people who would be deemed to be Indian residents will also be deemed to be not ordinarily resident. So clauses C and D have been added under section subsection 6, which means that finance bill provisions, 99% effect is neutralized. And that is why NRIs are not too much worried about it. But because of these amendments, there is a huge amount of controversy which has been brought in. To be able to understand the controversy in full depth, I have explained the history of section subsection 1 amendment. Now we are going into subsection 1A. Please note that this is a deeming provision, whereas earlier provision in amendment in explanation 1B is not a deeming provision. If a person falls within the conditions of that section, then he is deemed, he is considered to be an Indian resident. Here, under subsection 1A, the person who is covered there will be deemed to be Indian resident. And there is a lot of difference between the two, which we will discuss as we start discussing the controversies. Now here I have explained in paragraph 2.2 why this provision was brought in finance bill. Okay. Now there are people who would not just become non-resident of India, they would become non-resident of all the countries in the world. How is it possible? So once, supposing in India, they stay for less than 182 days. And for simplicity's sake, I'm saying a person stays in India for say 5 months every year. He is non-resident every year. Okay. Now, he finds out a country where the residential status provisions are similar. So in that country also, he stays for only 5 months in a year. The balance 2 months, he keeps traveling all over the world. Of course, this is a costly exercise and it is a sophisticated planning. So only very rich people can resort to this planning. But there are people who do this planning, so they do not become liable to tax for the status of residential status in any country around the world. Okay. Since they are not liable for the residential status, one liability is gone. Then they would create several SPVs in several tax havens, and most of their incomes would be earned by such tax havens having their double tax avoidance treaties with several countries. In the country of source also, they will be taxed at a nominal rate. It may be 10% or 15%. They will not pay full tax in any country. Now, this planning also came to the knowledge of Government of India, which means the commissioners who draft the income tax law in the CBDT. So they wanted to curb this tax avoidance also. Now look at the US government. In USA, a US citizen or even a green card holder is deemed to be US resident, or he is considered to be US tax resident, even if he does not stay for a single day in USA. Consider the illustration of an executive of a multinational corporation. He is deputed by the corporation outside USA. Okay, he is US citizen, but deputed to some other country. And let us say for 5 years continuously, he does not visit USA even for a single day. Even then, he would be considered to be US tax resident. His global income would be taxable in USA, subject only to the relief under double tax avoidance agreement. Okay. So Indian government also, now I'm not saying from any inside information, I don't have any inside information. Whatever I'm telling you is my assumption based on whatever I have read from newspapers and all that. Okay, so the government of India copied, almost copied the provision of taxation law in USA, which in effect meant that under section subsection 1A, if an Indian citizen or PIO was not liable to tax for the residential status in any country around the world, then in the initial finance bill provision was that such a person would be deemed to be Indian resident. Once he is deemed to be Indian resident, then the implications would be that his global income will become taxable. Of course, the global income becomes taxable only when he becomes resident as well as ordinarily resident. But his problems start. He has to file income tax return in India. And when he becomes resident and ordinary resident, then he has to disclose his foreign income and wealth in his Indian income tax return. If he has a business income, he would be liable to submit tax audit report and all that. So this was a huge amount of difficulty for people who were bona fide NRIs. Because while India was targeting people who were avoiding taxation, there were equally so many, in fact, in UAE, it is said that few million Indians are resident of UAE. Okay, now all these few million people are not liable to income tax through the connecting factor of residential status in any country around the world. So when you bring in a tax avoidance, anti-avoidance provision, you are simultaneously hitting the genuine bona fide investors also. So these people made a hue and cry, and I think from a very prominent doctor from UAE, he said he had made a huge investment in India, and if this provision is made applicable to him, he would rather stop investing in India than become liable to tax in India. All these things happened between the afternoon of 1st February and evening of 1st February. When the NRIs threatened that they will stop investing in India, immediately government of India became alert, and on 2nd February, CBDT issued a press note that genuine investors would not be affected. On 2nd February, we did not know what provision they will bring in. Okay, now then the finance bill has been passed, it became act. And as we all know, because of this COVID pandemic, the finance bill was not discussed in the parliament. It was straight away passed. And when we came to know about the Finance Act, I think it was published on 27th March or something, then we realized that what they have brought in is NOR status. Okay, so the people who would become Indian resident because of the explanation 1B, or because of the deeming provision of subsection 1A, they will also be deemed to be not ordinarily resident. Once they are not ordinarily resident, then they do not become liable to Indian tax on their foreign income. So immediately the NRIs, their protest and everything died down. So there are essentially two reliefs given now under the Finance Act. The first relief is that there is a threshold of 15 lakhs. Even now I am using simplified terminology. If a non-resident of India has income from India, the Indian income less than rupees 15 lakhs per financial year, then he will not be subject to these anti-avoidance provisions. Now at one stroke, let us say in UAE there are say 50 lakh people who are Indian citizens and working in UAE. Then probably 4 million people, 40 lakh people are middle class people or poor laborers. These are not the people whom government was targeting. These are not the people who will be doing sophisticated and costly tax planning. Okay. So automatically with this threshold of 15 lakhs, these 4 million people went out of the anti-avoidance provision. Now we are talking of the 1 million people who are rich enough. Of course, again, out of 1 million people, a much smaller number will be doing this sophisticated tax planning. A lot of rich NRIs in Dubai are also genuine NRIs of Dubai. They have not gone there for tax planning. They are doing their business in UAE. So to protect those bona fide NRIs staying in tax havens like UAE, government brought in the second relief, and that relief is that they shall be deemed to be NOR. Okay. Now these are the two. Sorry, there are first two anti-avoidance provisions. These two reliefs are anti-avoidance provisions. Now at this stage, I have raised a query which probably most of you already know the answer. The paragraph 2.8 I am referring to. But in one conference on one similar webinar, I heard the panelist asking a query that what is the significance of section 6? And this is what, as very briefly I explained earlier, here I have given illustrations and explained that Government of India gets jurisdiction to tax anybody for two connecting factors. One is residential status and second is the source of income. And the significance of section 6 lies in that it is providing the connecting factor of residential status. Okay. Now, even if a person is deemed to be Indian resident or considered to be an Indian resident, we have noticed that it is not the very first year in which he will become liable to Indian tax. It will be only when he becomes ordinarily resident that he will be liable to Indian income tax. Okay. Now, in paragraph Roman 3, I am discussing a few controversies which were all raised during the month of February before the Finance Act came. So, February and March, these controversies were discussed. After the amendment in subsection 6 and expansion of NOR status, most of these controversies have lost their significance. Hence, I will not go into too much detail, but at the same time, to understand the full implications of the controversies, I am briefly mentioning these controversies here. Okay. The first controversy is, if a person, an NRI, is staying in UAE, is he liable to tax in UAE? Okay. This controversy is a very old controversy under the old India-UAE double tax avoidance treaty. A person who was UAE resident, would he be entitled to get double tax avoidance relief? Okay, the controversy was like this. Double tax avoidance agreement essentially means that the SSE is liable to tax in two different countries. Now, UAE does not impose income tax on individual. So, the NRIs are not liable to income tax in UAE. In this situation, should they get the double tax avoidance agreement relief? This was the controversy. There were two contradictory rulings by the authority for advance ruling. In the case of M.A. Rafiq, M.A. Rafiq was a very prominent chartered accountant from India who had settled in UAE and he had a prominent practice. He himself made this application for the advance ruling. And the authority said that even though he is not liable to tax in UAE, he should get the TT relief. After 2 or 3 years, Mr. Cyril Pereira also filed an application, and there the authority for advance ruling raised this issue that there is no income tax on individuals in Dubai. Hence, Mr. Pereira is not liable to tax in Dubai. Hence, he is not entitled to the double tax avoidance agreement relief. Now, with that Cyril Pereira decision, a huge amount of controversy started. Now, Government of India decided that government wants investment from UAE. So, government wants to give relief to this UAE residents, whether there is double taxation or not. So, government amended Section 90, Subsection 1, and brought in into the clause that India can sign a treaty even for the purpose of strengthening economic relations, promoting trade and investment. So even if there is no double taxation, India can still sign a treaty. And simultaneously, by protocol, the India-UAE treaty was amended so that the requirement for liability to tax was avoided at least as far as the UAE treaty was concerned. With these two amendments, the issue about liability to tax and getting the treaty relief, it was resolved. So people were not worried. But again, when the government brought in subsection 1A and said that this kind of people who are not liable to tax in UAE, they will be deemed to be Indian residents. So again, the whole controversy started. Now, this was entirely unnecessary controversy, but the controversy started again. So let us again decide. Now, okay, of course, as I said already, that because of the NOR status provision, there is no problem for these NRIs staying in UAE. Still, it is possible after 2 years, some other government, some other commissioners will again bring in this issue. So let us get a clarity on the issue of liability to tax. In Dubai, the Sheikh has issued a decree. Now we understand clearly that in these kingdoms, law means a decree issued by the Sheikh. There is no parliament as such where the law will be passed. Now the Dubai Income Tax Decree of the year 1969, some of you who are researchers, you try to find out, you will not get it on any website. You will not get it on the Dubai website, you will not get it on UAE website also. It is one good friend from Dubai who had sent me this decree about 2 years, 2 decades back. So I have read the decree, and under the decree, what the government says is only foreign banks and oil corporations are liable to tax. Government does not impose any income tax on individuals. I also searched on the UAE government's website. And there is the UAE government's website. I have taken a screenshot, and that is what is now before you. I will read. The UAE does not levy income tax on individuals. Okay. Now, this screenshot I have taken in the month of March. Sorry, on the 6th February. And this is immediately after the finance bill controversy started. Now, point is, even as on today, government declares that they are not imposing any income tax on individuals. Then can you say that they are liable to tax in UAE? In my submission, NRIs staying in UAE, the individuals are not liable to tax in Dubai. Can we say that they are subject to tax in Dubai? This is another issue, and to explain this, let us say Indian population is 130 crores of individuals. Out of this, only 2 crore individuals are paying tax. Then there are 4 crore more individuals who probably are subject to some procedures under income tax, because either their income tax is deducted at source or there is some problem. Okay. Can we say that 128 crore people are liable to tax provided they have income of more than 2.5 lakh rupees? Unfortunately, in India, crores of people have their annual income being less than 2.5 lakh rupees, and probably with certain exemptions and all that, their income remains below taxable limit, which means that they are not subject to income tax. But can we say that they are liable to income tax? Okay, if their income crosses the threshold of 2.5 lakhs. Supposing today one boy is aged 24 years, his income is zero. He qualifies as a chartered accountant and joins a job with a salary of 1 lakh rupees per month. He now becomes liable to tax, but he was always subject to Indian income tax. Now, this is a controversy. The issue is, in Dubai, there is no income tax law only. It is not. It is unlike Indian situation, where government of India says if you cross the threshold, then you will be liable to tax or you will be subject to tax. In Dubai, under the law itself, people are not liable to income tax. Hence, even under this argument, my view is that these NRIs staying in UAE are not liable to income tax in Dubai. They are not even subject to income tax in Dubai. They are getting tax residency certificates. But as we all know, while the UAE government does not collect a single rupee tax or a single dinar tax, they still give TRC. That is okay for claiming their treaty relief, because government of India has made the necessary amendments and government will give treaty relief if the person holds a TRC. But the provision of section 61A, I mean subsection 1A, is completely different from the provisions of section 90. So under subsection 1A, these kind of people could be deemed to be Indian residents because they are not liable to tax in Dubai. Now, some of you may be aware of the fact that rich people can even purchase citizenship. And here in this illustration, I have considered the case of a tax haven, St. Kitts Island. Okay, it is situated in West Indies. We know West Indies more from the point of view of cricket. Geographically, it is one of the island between the North America, the continent of North America, in the continent of South America, somewhere near the Panama Canal. Okay, now I don't know the current price, but there was a time when if you make investment of 2 crore rupees in St. Kitts Island, then St. Kitts Island will give you citizenship. Okay, you will never go in your lifetime to St. Kitts Island. You will travel around the world on a passport issued by that government. Okay. Now, when a person purchases a citizenship like this, will he be free from the subsection 1A? Will he be free from anti-avoidance provision under subsection 1A? In my view, probably the GAR provisions will apply, because for the person, the principal purpose for purchase of citizenship was to avoid Indian tax. He would continue to stay in UAE. He would have business in UAE, he would have business in India also, he would have investments in India, he would be visiting India regularly every year, and he would not be visiting St. Kitts Island even for a single day in a year. So probably GAR provisions would apply, and purchase of citizenship would not be a sound protection against the anti-avoidance provision. With these three main paragraphs, I have discussed the anti-avoidance provisions. Now I am coming to subsection 6, the NOR status. We may read this NOR provision. The first line is, a person is said to be NOR in India in any previous year if such person is. And then the subsection gives 4 conditions. It used to give 2 conditions, clause A and clause B. Clause A for individuals and clause B. I'm sorry, there is an error. I'm correcting the error here. Yeah, so clauses A and B are there for a long time. Under these clauses, a person could be NOR either for 2 years or at the maximum 3 years. Now, each clause is individual, as you would know, that each clause is succeeded by the word or. So clauses C and D, which have been added by Finance Act, they are independent of clauses A and B. Now let us look at clause C. Clause C is to give relief to people who are considered to be Indian resident under explanation 1B, which means if a person visits India for more than 120 days and he has Indian income of more than 15 lakhs of rupees, then he is considered to be Indian resident. Okay, but that person under this clause C of subsection 6 will also be considered to be NOR. And since he will be considered to be NOR, he will be almost free from all the tax liabilities in India. Clause D is for the purpose of subsection 1A. If an NRI, if a citizen of India is deemed to be Indian resident under subsection 1A, then automatically he is also deemed to be NOR. There is no other condition to be fulfilled by him. So all these rich people automatically are not subject to Indian income tax on their foreign incomes. Now comes the explanation at the end of subsection 6. And this explanation is borrowed from section 5, subsection 1, proviso. And this has created a whole lot of controversy. Which controversy we will discuss. Before discussion, just for the ease of in understanding the provision, I am reading out the explanation. For the purposes of this section, the expression income from foreign sources means income which accrues or arises outside India. So this is fine, which is a normal meaning. If your income is sourced outside India, then it is foreign sourced income and it shall not be counted for two purposes. For the purpose of computing the threshold of 15 lakhs as well as for the taxability under section 5. But from this relief giving provision, there is a further exception, and that is given in the bracket. Except income derived from. Now, derived from is an important phrase. Then there are further two phrases. Derived from a business controlled in or a profession set up in India. Now, what is the meaning of this exception or this explanation? This is what we will discuss further. I'm on paragraph Roman 4.3. We should note that this is relief is a permanent relief. You know, under clause A and B of NOR status, a person could get NOR status for 2 years or maximum 3 years. But these provisions C and D, as long as the conditions continue to apply, a person will be NOR. Just for an illustration, let us say Mr. Patel is a resident of UAE. He has, within India, he has a huge income. He has properties in India. He is conducting business in India. But he has also got business and income in UAE. Now, he visits India for 120 days. But every year, he visits India for less than 181 days. Now, this kind of a person shall be deemed to be Indian resident. Simultaneously, he will be NOR also. This situation may continue for 10 years, 20 years, so on. So we will continuously be exempt from Indian income tax. Now, what is happening is that we have to look at the combined provisions. Instead of trying to interpret one section or one sentence, we have to look at section 6.1, section 6.1A, as well as subsection 6, and then section 5. Paragraph 4.2, section 6.1c, this we have already discussed. I will not discuss. Now, with the amendment, the number of days are reduced to 119. Simultaneously, the person becomes NOR, hence he is not liable to Indian tax on his foreign income. This we have seen. I'm sorry, I have put up a wrong article here. Mr. Vivek Vitlani is a chartered accountant practicing in Ahmedabad. He is a good friend. He has made an excellent article on this NOR status and all that. But this provision I have removed from the article which I have published earlier. So let me look and come to another. Okay, now I'm paragraph Roman 4.4, and this what we were discussing were the combined implications of section 6.1.1a and subsection 6. Let us look at this paragraph 4.2. Yeah, sorry, this we have already seen. Now we wanted to discuss more of paragraph 4.5, permanent relief also we have discussed. Income from foreign sources. This is a major controversy, and I have again repeated section 6.1c with a specific purpose. I have analyzed this section by breaking up each phrase separately, and this gives a lot of clarity. So I'm reading this subsection 1c. A citizen of India or a person of Indian origin having total income other than income from foreign sources exceeding 15 lakh rupees during the previous year, as referred to in explanation 1b, who has been in India for a period or periods amounting in all to more than 120 days but less than 182 days. This is section 6.1c. Now 6.6 explanation, this also we have read very recently. Except income derived from or a business controlled in or a profession set up in India. Okay. Now the controversy is this: when we want to consider the income derived from, should we consider only that individual's income or income derived from a partnership firm or an AOP or a trust or from a company? Now this is the major controversy which I will discuss right now. And I have given a few illustrations here. This paragraph 5.2 refers to a very old history of even going before 1961 Act, the provisions which were in the year in the 1922 Act, and why 5.1c had a specific proviso. This, of course, you can read a little later. I would like to go to the controversy. And to explain the controversy, I have taken illustrations. Now, the first illustration is of a professional firm. In the paragraph 4.1 now, I am saying that let us assume that there is a partnership firm of XYZ. This is a firm of lawyers. The firm is set up in India. I have given three illustrations in this article. And in all the three cases, let us understand a situation. Litigation and controversies can be on account of two situations. The litigation may be on account of facts, or litigation may be on account of legal interpretation. Now, as far as facts, there will be huge controversies, there will be huge litigation, but that we cannot discuss in an academic article. So what we are discussing here is only the legal interpretation. So facts are given, very clean facts. This gentleman, this partnership firm XYZ has five partners. Four partners are Indian residents. They are looking after the Indian business. They may travel abroad, but only for short visits. There is a fifth partner who is Indian citizen, but a non-resident of India. In short, ICNR. Okay. Now, he mainly looks after the foreign client. So the partnership firm XYZ has set up a branch in London. This ICNR is situated in London. He is resident of Britain. He takes his salary from his British branch. And of course, he earns a share of profit from the XYZ partnership firm, wherein he earns a share of profit from the Indian business also and from the international business also. Now, for him, what are the legal implications? The partnership firm, under the current law, it is the firm which pays tax. And as you people are aware, there was a time when firm paid only maximum 24% tax. Then the share of profit was distributed to partners. Then the partners again paid tax on their share of profit. But as on today, partners are exempted from Indian income tax on their share of profit from the partnership firm, because the firm pays full tax on the net profit. But the salary earned by the partner from the partnership firm is not taxed in the hands of the partnership firm. It is taxed in the hands of the individual partner. Now that makes our illustration interesting. Mr. ICNR earns a salary from London branch. The London branch is a branch of a profession set up in India. Can we say that this salary income is derived from a profession set up in India? This is the controversy. The income is earned by the partnership firm. The main income is earned by the partnership firm. The partner earns his salary. He earns it in British India. Now, can such liabilities, can such income be considered for the threshold of 15 lakhs? And can it be considered for the scope of total income under Section 5(1) under the proviso? This is the issue. Now, my submission is we should again look at the language of the law. The Section 6 is entirely, I mean, Section 6(1)(1A) and subsection 6, they are all pertaining to individual. So one view is that you consider only the individual's own income. Another view is that as far as the income is to be considered, of course we consider the individual's income. It will be the individual's income which will be liable to tax in India under Section 5, and which will be considered for the threshold. But if that income is derived from a business or a profession, now who owns that business or who owns that profession is not provided in the explanation. So the business may be controlled by, business may be owned by a professional firm, and our ICNR earns salary from that professional firm, then is it liable to be considered? In my submission, yes. And my answer is yes, because explanation nowhere says that the business should also be owned by the individual ICNR. It does not say that the profession should be set up by ICNR. ICNR may have joined the professional firm later on. The professional, for example, the XYZ partnership firm might have been set up in the year 2000. ICNR joined the partnership firm in the year 2010. But he had not set up the profession. He is only an employee of, he is a, of course, working partner, and as an employee partner of the partnership firm. But still, because the profession was set up in India and he is deriving his salary from the partnership firm, he will be considered for the threshold. So since he is coming to India for 120 days or more, he will be deemed to be an Indian resident under subsection 1, explanation 1B, and he will be liable to tax in India under Section 5. This is the my answer, and on this issue there is a lot of difference of opinion, and I say that every participant may study this provision and may form his own view. Then I am giving another illustration. There is an Indian company, ABC Private Limited. This Indian company has incorporated a subsidiary in London. Okay, the subsidiary is 100% subsidiary. Even then, it is possible to say that subsidiary is independently controlled and managed by a board of directors in London. It is possible. But in this illustration, I am saying that the British subsidiary is controlled by Indian company, so that the business conducted by the British subsidiary is controlled from India. Okay, so it clearly satisfies the conditions provided in the explanation to Section 6, subsection 6. Now, Mr. Iyer is a senior manager in the subsidiary. He stays in London for about 240 days and he visits India for more than 120 days every year. His salary, of course, he receives in British pounds, which very clearly exceeds the threshold of 15 lakhs. Now, what are the provisions? I would submit that the explanation says, is the business controlled from India? Answer is yes. Okay. Is he getting a salary? Is he deriving his income from that business? answer is yes. Since the answer is yes, he will be considered to be an Indian resident under explanation 1B, and his income, the British salary, will be subject to Indian income tax. Of course, the double tax avoidance agreement between India and UK will apply, and because of the treaty provision, first he will have to apply Article 4(2). He will be, see, under Indian Income Tax Act, he will be deemed to be Indian resident. Under the British law, he is considered to be British resident. So we have to apply the tie-breaking rules. And if the tie-breaking rules, of course, this is a very subjective issue. And on facts basis, on tie-breaking rules, there can be a whole lot of litigation. In our situation, in our illustration, if we assume that Mr. Iyer is on tie-breaking provisions considered to be a UK resident, then under the treaty, he will not be liable to Indian income tax. Now, similarly, I have given a third illustration that there is a Shah family, Indian resident. They have incorporated a company in UAE, and that company has 100 different employees. Okay. Now, those 100 employees, out of those 100 employees, there may be a lot of employees who have no connection with India. But there are some employees who are Indian citizens, whose this income exceeds 15 lakhs of rupees. And out of these employees, still there are some executives who visit India for more than 120 days. Okay. Now, for clarity in understanding the provision, I'm taking an extreme provision that this Shah family's company in UAE, there is Mr. Patel employed in the company. He is not a relative of Shah. He has nothing to do with Shah family. But his business requires that he visits India for 3 or 4 months every year. Even then, he will be covered by the deeming provisions. He will be considered to be an Indian resident, and he will be subject to Indian income tax. So now there are 1 lakh companies in UAE. Lot of companies are controlled from India. Okay. Now, so many executives would be visiting India for a number of days, and they will all be subject to these controversies. Hence, my submission is that this Finance Act provision has opened up a Pandora's box. They have opened up a whole lot of controversies, and a whole lot of people will be subject to Indian income tax. Now, all of us will have to examine these provisions in detail and then come to a decision whether and how these provisions will apply. My practice is always to say that I do not want my client to fight at all. Okay. There are some consultants who will say, yes, we can fight up to Supreme Court, and I'm confident that we will win. But that is not a safe course of action in the current times. In my submission, the safe course of action is his income tax assessment should be completed at the officer level, assuming that the officer is honest, is not unnecessarily harassing you. Then your facts should be such and your plan should be such that your assessment gets through and you don't get into litigation. From this safe practice point of view, I have raised all the controversies. It is possible that Government of India is aware of these controversies. They will come out with clarifications and they will provide some relief. Now, due to this current lockdown situation, probably Government has not come out with any clarifications. It is possible that they will come out with clarifications, and then our clients can have less of controversies. With that, my friends, I am concluding my presentation, and I am open for any queries to be discussed.
Thank you, Rasmin bhai.
Yes, sir. Welcome.
I'm reading the query.
Please.
Mr. X is a citizen of India and resident and ordinary resident of India by virtue of his stay in India. Mr. X also holds US green card, and according to tiebreaker rule as per Indo-US DTAA, Mr. X is a resident of India. The question is now, the first sub question, in what capacity should he file the return in the US? Non-resident in view of tiebreaker, or resident in view of the residency by virtue of holding of the green card? Another question in the same context, which country has a right to tax its global income, especially when the US tax law provides for considering the person resident of the US based on the holding of the green card? If it is India, then he will get the tax credit of the tax paid in the US of the US income.
So you are right. I have some observations. First of all, this query does not arise from Section 6. Hello?
Yes, Rasmin Bhai.
This query does not arise from the presentation which I have made today.
Okay, right. Got it.
Can answer the query, but my request is if you have time available, okay, I don't know how many queries you have received.
The queries are very few.
Okay, then I will deal with this query. Okay.
See, could I WhatsApp to you the query?
Yeah, please go ahead and WhatsApp. Yeah.
I have sent.
Okay, I'll get it because I closed down my phone. So I will get it. Okay, now the point is, this gentleman, the SSC, let us say one Mr. X, he is a green card holder. So US government has made such provisions that a person who is a green card holder, he will not be entitled to treaty relief. So as far as USA is concerned, he will not get any relief under the treaty. But India is more reasonable. India says, yes, we will apply the tie-breaking provision. We will give you even the treaty relief. Now, the issue is this. He is staying in India. He is Indian resident, but he would have income from USA. So government of India will say, we will apply India-US treaty. We will consider you as a resident of India, and your US income, we will give you tax relief. We will give you relief under Article 23 or 24, as the case may be. But we will give, for example, in USA, an individual may be subject to, say, 35% income tax. Now, India will say, if under the treaty, the tax should have been only 10%, then we will give you relief of only 10%. We will not give you 35% relief. He would be paying the state income tax. He would be paying the city income tax also. As probably by now, everybody understands that in USA, there is income tax imposed by the federal government or the central government, state government, and even the city municipality. So under the treaty, he will not get relief from the state income tax and the city income tax. He would be paying social security and medical benefits on those kind of taxes also. That also will not be available for relief. So my point is, yes, India will give relief to him under the treaty, but he will be liable to Indian income tax on his global income. In USA, it becomes a very complicated provision, and he has to seek relief, seek advice from a US expert. Okay, I think we can go forward.
Sir, the question is on screen itself. It talks about COVID-19 crisis came around mid of March 2020. That is nearly a year ahead. So while doing transfer pricing report, can we take a plea that margins are reduced due to COVID-19? Will departments accept the stand? And secondly, comparable companies will also facing same issues. Another question, what to do where there is already contract between holding and subsidiary company for providing management services, where already a pre-agreed markup is mentioned? What to do for that contract for the year 19-20? Do any impact of COVID-19 should be given, and if to be given, how to justify? Sir, if you can reply.
Kishan bhai, as you know, again, this query also does not pertain to my presentation of today. That is point one. It is pertaining to transport pricing provisions. Now, I am not an expert on transport pricing.
You said we can skip.
Sorry?
Sir, if you want to, skip.
Yeah, I will give only a brief answer. That this COVID-19 crisis is such a huge crisis, nobody can ignore it. If you are a transfer pricing auditor, you have to take care of it. And even the income tax officer, whoever will be the officer, has to give cognizance of this crisis. Now, because of this crisis, probably a lot of companies will be incurring substantial losses. And nobody will be able to say that, no, now you have to comply with so-and-so margin. And in fact, what is the market price? That itself is an issue. So in short, my answer is, yes, COVID-19 crisis must be considered while considering transfer pricing provisions.
Okay. Thank you, Rasmus. The next question. Whether exempt income from profit of Indian partnership or the firm that shall be included in calculating the limit of 15 lakhs. And another regarding the 15 lakhs, the another same question is interest income from another account that is also displayed on the screen.
And it has been asked by CA Kantibai Karkar. So if you can answer it.
Kantibai, namaste.
One is regarding the partnership income and this one.
Okay. So partnership income, of course, I have already answered during the presentation itself. Now, as far as the interest income from NRE account fund, okay. Now, NRE account interest income is exempted under section 10, right? So, in my submission, this income cannot be taxed. As long as the person remains to be a non-resident under FEMA, then he will continue his NRE account. And his NRE account interest will be exempt from Indian income tax. Hence, it will not be counted either for the threshold nor for the purpose of section 5.
Okay, thank you, sir.
As far as partnership is concerned, I think I have already replied.
Yeah.
The next question is Mr. X is a citizen of India.
The similar question. He is Indian resident as well as a green card holder under the. See, the query is in what capacity should he file return in USA? See, as far as USA is concerned, is there a difference in the severity with which? Sorry, please. And now I'm reading the screen. Okay. In what capacity should he file return in USA? In USA, he will have to file return as if he is a US tax resident. Indian law and any amendment in Indian law will not change the US law. Under USA, he is tax resident of USA. Now, which country has a right to tax his global income? Well, here, both countries have a right to tax his global income. See, now this is an important provision we must understand, that income tax is a country subject. The nation government decides who will be liable to tax. Under the double tax avoidance treaty, he may be given a relief, he may not be given a relief. But treaty does not decide the right to levy tax. That is decided by the domestic law. The US domestic law holds him as US resident, so he is liable to US tax on his global income. Indian law holds him as Indian resident, so he is liable to Indian tax on his global income. This is clearly double taxation. In normal situations, most of the treaties provide for elimination of double taxation, but USA says no. Once a person is treated as US resident, we will not give him any treaty relief. So in USA, he will be subject to a lot of controversies, but Indian government will give him treaty relief. And the treaty relief which will be available to him, that I have already explained, but I'll go further on this query. Which country has a right, that I have answered. Can we go down further? There is one more paragraph in this query now. Bishan bhai, can you go down?
It's a different query. So this is it. Sunil bhai, now you can take another question.
Yeah. Rasman bhai, the next question. Till DTAA supersedes the tax
liability. I have answered.
Rasman bhai, I am reading the next query.
Okay, please.
Till DTAA supersedes tax liability raised under Section 6. Means income taxable in India can get the benefit of DTAA?
Okay, now you see this wording, whether DT supersedes the tax liability raised under Section 6. So this is not the correct language. The point is, India is a reasonable country. See, in India, we complain about government of India. But whenever international tax issues come up, Indian government always behaves very reasonably. So India has accepted a situation that DT overrides the domestic law. And there are Supreme Court decisions, I mean High Court decisions also, which government of India has not contested. So it is a settled issue that the treaty overrides the domestic law. Now the issue is, what is the jurisdiction of a treaty? Please understand that the treaty has only one thing to do, and that the country of source will tax the SSE at a lower rate. To simplify, if India is a country of source, in a particular income of a non-resident is liable to tax in India, then India may reduce its right to tax to say 10% or 15%. Who is earning interest income from India, India will say we will not levy 35% tax, we will levy only 10% tax. But beyond the reduction in the rate of tax, the treaty generally cannot travel beyond that. Section 6 is a deeming provision. Okay, so Section 6 will prevail. So India may say that a particular person becomes Indian resident under the amended provisions of Section 6. Then under the treaty, we have to go to Article 4.2, tie-breaking provisions. In the tie-breaking provision, we will decide whether the person becomes resident of one country or the other. Does it give clarity?
Yes,
Rasmi. Yes. Sir, the last question is, yes. Is there a difference in text in the extent of severity with which authorities in India will challenge foreign incomes for an NRO and NOR versus NRI? Either way, foreign income is exempt, but will the status per se determine level of potential drilling from an enforcement agency on SSE's foreign income?
What will a particular officer do? It is difficult to estimate, but I can share with you my own experience. Now, I am a person who loves India, and I always tell, wait about how much time? Give about 5 minutes.
Sir, I have
2 minutes to give.
Yes, yes.
No, we can have 5-10 minutes.
Okay. So I'll give a detailed answer, which makes so many things clear to people, participants here. See, I have a client who is a British citizen who left India at the age of 22 years for further studies. Then he got jobs abroad and he made a lot of money. Okay. Now, I tell all my NRI clients that please invest in India in such a manner that you have a house in India and 10% of your wealth you invest in India. What is the logic behind this? Because we have seen that so many countries around the world have crisis. And when they meet with a crisis, all these NRIs run to India. When you run to India, and if you have nothing left in India, then the situation can be bad. So my client took my advice and he invested substantial amount of money into India. Now, 10% for him meant 400 crores of rupees. Okay. He actually invested 400 crores of rupees in India and his age was 35 years. Now, I tell you, 6 different agencies of government of India started inquiries against him. Enforcement Directorate, Income Tax Department, Investigation Wing, serious fraud office, economic intelligence wing, like that six agencies said, this boy is of 35 years, how could he invest 400 crores in India? Okay. Now my partner Naresh Ajwani dealt with the case. He met each and every agency. He established that this boy has earned income from genuine sources. We established all the facts, but I think 6 or 7 years have passed. For all these 7 years, he keeps getting 20 different notices from different authorities every year. He has been harassed so much that my client has decided, and when I went to some other business, I had gone to London, I met my client, he started firing me. He held me guilty that you advised me to invest in India, I invested in India, and now I'm suffering tremendous amount of difficulties with all Indian government agencies. And he used these words. He said, Rasmin, I will go to the rooftop and shout that don't invest in India. Okay. Now, actually, this is what the NRIs who invest in India are suffering. It is not a solitary case. There are many cases of NRIs who invest in India and they face a lot of difficulties from India. Okay. Now, what is the moral of the lesson? Moral to be drawn from this fact. The fact is, if you are an NRI, do not expect that government of India will treat you with, silken gloves. They will not give you any special status. You will have to prove your income, your source of income, everything beyond any doubt. You know, especially people who come from UAE, they say that in our country, there is no requirement for audit. We do not even maintain books of account. You have no business asking me about my foreign income. Now, friends, please understand that this ground is not accepted by government of India. If the NRI cannot prove his source of income, then under section 68-69, his income is deemed to be black money or his income is taxed in India and he faces a lot of consequences. Okay, friends.
Thank you, Rasmin. One last question is there. Vishan Bhai. Rasmin, it is regarding that they want some more examples on business control in India or profession setup in India. That concept maybe is discussed.
You see, I have given three illustrations with an idea that three different kinds of situations are covered. But I'll give you one more illustration. I think, this illustration of Mr. Shah, who is running his business from India, but has set up a company in UAE. Okay. Now, that kind of situation is a widespread situation, and a lot of people can come into difficulty unless government of India issues a circular or notification and give them sharing. Now, there can be other subsidiaries like, people who are in UK, USA, Malaysia, Australia, where there is a domestic law. And if there is a domestic income tax, then people will get double tax avoidance relief and genuine cases will most likely not come into trouble. It is only people who are in tax havens that they will come into trouble.
Okay, thank you, Rasmin Bhai. Vishan Bhai, over to you.
Yes, thank you very much, sir. On behalf of WNFC of ICAI, Ahmedabad branch, sir, we all are thankful to you that you showered your knowledge on us. And as a Bhishma Pitama of the subject, we all are enriched from you, sir. So, once again, thank you very much. With the folded hands, sir.
Thank you, everybody. My thanks to the branch and thanks to all the participants. Thank you.
And
thank you, all the participants. We are going to meet tomorrow at 12 p.m. As Vijay Bhai is going to address us. So I request all join at 12 p.m. tomorrow, and we'll be having our last session at that time. So thank you very much, friends. And we are ending this webinar here. Thank you.